This little light of mine,
I'm going to let it shine.
This little light of mine,
I'm going to let it shine.
This little light of mine,
I'm going to let it shine.
Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Gonna take this light all around the world.
I'm going to let it shine.
Gonna take this light all around the world. Gonna take this light all around the world.
I'm gonna let it shine.
Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Through this little light of mine,
I'm gonna let it shine.
Yeah, this little light of mine,
I'm gonna let it shine.
This little light of mine,
I'm gonna let it shine.
Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Well, I won't let anybody put me down. I'm gonna let it shine. I won't let anyone put me down. I'm gonna let it shine. Won't let anyone put me down. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. This little
light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine.
This little light of mine,
I'm gonna let it shine.
This little light of mine,
I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Unless you return You'd be better off dropped in the middle of a lake with a millstone around your neck, doomed to the world for giving these God-believing children a hard time. Hard times are inevitable, but you don't have to make it worse, and it's doomsday to you if you do. If your hand or your foot gets in the way of God, chop it off and throw it away. You're better off maimed or lame and alive than the proud owners of two hands and two feet, godless in a furnace of eternal fire. And if your eye distracts you from God, pull it out and throw it away. You're better off one-eyed and alive than exercising your 20/20 vision from inside the fire of hell. Watch that you don't treat a single one of these childlike believers arrogantly. You realize, don't you, that their personal angels are constantly in touch with my Father in heaven. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Lord God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts in our hearts and minds in all of us be honoring to you, O Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So today is Rally Day, and for some of us, this is old hat, right? Rally Day may have been something that we've been doing since as long as we can remember. I'm pretty sure that this is a Presbyterian thing because I've talked to some other denominations and they have no idea what I'm talking about. And I'm pretty sure this is also a Western Pennsylvania thing. But Rally Day is a day when we remember and we restart our church year, specifically with a focus on our Christian education, our Sunday school. Unless you think that you are being left out, we have a phenomenal Sunday school class right over there. We're starting a conversation on what does it mean to be in union, in Christian unity, even when we disagree. That started this week, but we read the first chapter for next week. Interestingly, there has been a study on what keeps kids in the church. One of the things, of the three indicators of whether kids will stay in church is whether their church has a vibrant adult Sunday school program. An adult Sunday school program shows kids that we are still lifelong learners, that we don't believe that you graduate from Sunday school, that we don't believe that you stop learning about God, about God's word, about ourselves. That's one of the three top indicators of whether kids stay in church. The other one is whether they know an adult. They know seven adults by name and you know them by name. The magic number is seven. But there are adults that are not their pastor or their parents who greet them by name, who shake their hand, who give them high five at the passing of the peace, who ask them about school, who pray for them, who show up at their school events to cheer them on. At least seven adults in the church who know them by name and know what's going on in their lives. So, Rally Day is for all of us, right? So the scripture today is about kids. But I want to remind us first that God calls us all children of God, right? Romans 8 says that anyone who walks by the Spirit is a child of God, okay? So you and I, no matter what our chronological or spiritual age, we are all kids to God. One of the things that I want to remind us is of our baptism. We are welcomed in baptism to be called children of God. We are adopted into the family of faith. One of the reasons that we Presbyterians baptize infants, we baptize people who maybe didn't get the opportunity to be baptized as an infant or child. We absolutely have a baptism of belief, believer's baptism. But one of the reasons that we baptize infants is to remind both the family, but all of us at every baptism, that there is nothing that you can do to earn this. So we start when they aren't potty trained and they're not able to eat on their own and they're not able to say, yes, I love Jesus. We start. start when they're super young so that there's never any, I can earn this. Because if you think about it, you did not earn being born to the parents that you got. You didn't earn it. You didn't pick them. You were born. It was a passive act. So we are children of God, all of us, no matter what our chronological age. And so we are called to remember that we are children. But interestingly enough, Jesus actually tells us to act like children too. So I wonder what we can learn from kids. Did you know that we're supposed to learn from you guys? Did you know that? So we're supposed to learn from you guys. So, kids, have you ever been asked the question, why? Have you ever been asked that question by a kid? Have you ever been asked it over and over and over again? Have you ever been asked why? It's been researched that we have actually not done a very good job of passing down the why of what we do things, our tradition. We teach kids this is what we do, but we aren't necessarily good at passing down the why we do it, why we stand, why we light candles, why we do this, why we pray here. And it's true not just about the faithful life, the religious life, but it's also true we have not always done a good job of passing down the why. And yet kids are not afraid to ask, why are we doing this? They ask other great questions as well. I've got permission. I always have permission to share these stories. Some of them come from my children. I have permission to share. I have been asked, this is a great question. Is Jesus a zombie? Because Jesus was alive, and then he died, and then he's undead. So is Jesus a zombie? It's a kid from a 10 or 11 year old. Is that a good question? Right? That's a good question. Well, no, this is why we don't believe Jesus is a zombie. Zombies are like unable to think, unable to eat. They just are kind of like moving through life, not thinking. They're just doing, right? But Jesus is able to be fully alive. He's not undead. He's alive. And there is a difference. A great question, right? I was asked by one of my own children. Actually, my husband was asked. He gets the lucky job of trying to translate what I have to say. We were singing a song a couple of weeks ago where it says, change my heart, oh God. That was the one. Change my heart, oh God. And the line is, you are the potter, I am the clay. Right? You are the potter, I am the clay. The question? Which potter? Harry Potter? You laugh. But that's a good question. We try to convey our faith in language of metaphor. But research says that children don't understand metaphor until they're 8, 9, 10 years old. We talk about God as a good shepherd. We talk about God as the rock. But that is not translatable. Kids ask good questions. And I don't know when it happens, but at some point we stop asking questions. I told this story in Sunday school, and they kind of get a preview sometimes. I remember sitting next to my smarter husband in a class when I was learning to be a pastor. And he got into an argument with one of our professors. And our professor said, John, are you arguing metaphysics with me? He said, yes. Do you know what I did? I Googled, what is metaphysics? At what point did I stop asking questions? There is no dumb question, and our kids remind us of that. They're figuring out the life of faith. They know that they are learners, and they ask, and they want to find out. But at some point, I stop asking that question, right? I don't want to look stupid. I don't want to be the only one. Nobody else seems to be confused, so it must be me. Kids are like, hey, shouldn't we be lifelong learners? If we're considered children of God, we're supposed to be learning about who God is and who God has created us to be. Why shouldn't we be more like children who are willing to ask the why questions, who are willing to ask the questions that they don't understand with no shame? How do we be more like children?
I mean, picture. It's tiny.
I also noticed that, I know it's surprising, but my children have never complained that dinner every night is a handout. They never complain and think that they should pay their due. They understand that the loving parent should provide for them. Right?
A new girl.
But at some point, we start to think that we need to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. We need to do it on our own. And God is an afterthought. We pray when we are in the foxhole, in the troublesome situation when we're worried or when we're when something bad has happened. But when everything is good, we forget sometimes to pray. My kids have no problem receiving handouts. Right? My kids have no problem understanding that there are people in their lives that are supposed to take care of everything. They're not supposed to do everything for themselves. That they're part of a community and a family, and yet somehow we lose that when we get older. And then there's some kids have this trust, right? This humbleness, this trust, right? That the adults in their lives, hopefully, will take care of them. If they have been raised in a Christian home, hopefully they know that God loves them. How do we have the ability, the humility to ask questions, the humility, the willingness to let God provide for us, not just through our own hard work, but through our neighbor's hard work, as well as miraculous means from God? How do we be like children? How do we be like children? Because we all are kids of the Creator God, of the Father God who created the entire universe and created you. We are the beloved child. And what we know about belonging is that we oftentimes in the church get it wrong. The church has had a habit throughout more recent history, not maybe in the book of Acts, I'm not sure when it changed, but we started to say for kids, us as kids as adults, because we're all kids, as well as kids themselves, we started to say that you have to believe a certain thing. You have to have a statement of faith. Right? You have to believe certain things to be a part of this group. And then it says that you have to behave a certain way. You have to stand when you're supposed to stand, you're supposed to sit when you're supposed to sit, you're supposed to, some traditions you have to praise like this, some traditions you have to praise like this, depending on the tradition. You have to behave a certain way. And then you belong. Diana Butler Bass, a scholar and author, wrote a book called Christianity After Religion. I've talked about this before with many of you, but this has been one of those books that has just clicked for me and transformed my thinking. She argues that the way Jesus works, the way the church ought to work, is that you belong. Right? Each one of you, you belong as you are. Come as you are. Just as I am, out of one belief. Right? The hymn. You belong. You belong before you have the answers. You belong before you know what you believe. You belong before you know what these crazy Christians are doing and when to stand and when to sit. You belong. And then you will learn by being with others who do this thing called faith in church. You will then learn how to behave, what to do when. What are we singing now? And then you will slowly learn what you believe. And dare I say, it might be different than the person next to you, but you will slowly learn what you believe. Another book that was transformational, a man by the name of James K. Smith wrote a book, You Are What You Love. And Smith argues that it is our habits that form us. And so it is that behaving that Bass talks about that helps form us into what we believe. And so we don't start reading scripture because we love God more. We start reading scripture and fall in love with the God from scripture. We don't believe that we'll be better at something. And so we practice, and then we get better. Our thoughts, he argues, so often do not affect us as much as our behaviors. There was one study that doctors did that 90% of people that were told that if you don't change your diet and your exercise, 90% of people, if you don't change your diet or exercise, you will be God because of the way your heart and your heart is working. 90% say, that's great. Only approximately 10% of people who receive that news are able to think their way into behaviors because our habits are what form us. You are what you love. You love what you do, and that forms who you become. And so, we belong. If you were baptized, you might have been baptized as an infant. You did nothing to earn that. You belong before you can do anything else. And then we learn what that looks like. I went to a hockey game with my husband a couple of years ago, and I learned what all this stuff was, and I learned when to throw the hat and when to do all that stuff because I was sitting with people who knew. You learn after you belong, you behave. And then you learn what you believe. And hopefully it's not, you know, loving hockey. Hopefully it's loving Jesus. So this time I want to talk to the kids. You all can listen in. So look at me.
Okay, look at mom.
Hey, this is your church, right? This may have been your parents' church, or your grandparents' church, or your great-grandma's church. This is your church, right? You belong here. This is your church. We want you to know first and foremost that you are loved. If you don't have the answers, if you're not sure what's supposed to happen next, that's okay. Right? We want you to know belonging. And that idea of belonging, that might be a word that I'm going to get yelled at later, and I'm going to have to explain it, so I'm going to explain it now. It means that there's a place here for you. Right? That you, with your wiggles and your questions and your uncertainty, and the things that have gone good in your life and the things that have gone bad in your life, anything that you bring with you, you belong here. And there are adults here, your parents, your grandparents, your friends. There are people who are going to help you figure that out. But it starts with you knowing that, yeah, this is your parents' church. This is your church. Okay? This is your church. Not just your parents, not just your grandparents. Okay? Jesus says over and over again how important it is to pass on the faith. He says over and over again how we are to care for children and how we are supposed to be like children. And adults, that is hard. I have been to churches that have just shipped all the kids off, right? I have been to the church where there's a program for the nursery, and then there's a pre-K church, and then there's an elementary school church, and then there's a high school church, and then when they get to be seniors in high school and they come, they sit with me. That was my role at this church that I was at. And they don't understand any of what we're doing. Because they've only ever been with people who are like them, who think like them, who are their age group, their demographic. We are blessed in the church to be one of the only organizations that's intergenerational, not multi-generational where we kind of coexist, but we are intergenerational. It is easier to just hang out with people who are like us. But that is not what we are called to do. The disciples think that they're protecting Jesus because he's tired. In the passage that Shane read, they think they're doing what's right. Jesus is, his time is valuable. And Jesus rebukes them. He tells them no. It's sometimes harder to have our lives interrupted. It's sometimes harder to be asked why over and over and over again. But we are called to be like children. And we are called to welcome children. We are called to be like children, to learn from them, to ask the good questions, because there is no bad question, to trust, to be humble like children, to accept the fact that there are people that are called to take care of us. We are called to love children, yes. We are also called to be like children. At the end of our worship service, I want to offer you an opportunity. A couple of weeks ago, I was at a seminar for pastors, and they started with the chapel. We normally have the baptismal font you know, here or here, so that you can see it, and so that it kind of reminds you who you are, your identity. But for this day, I moved it in the back, okay? So it is near impossible to leave this church without walking past it. If you feel comfortable, I invite you, no matter how old you are, stick your hands in it. And I know it's really fun to play in water, right? It's real fun to play in water. You're not allowed to flick anybody else.
Yeah.
Put your hands in. Put water on yourself. Only on yourself. And remind yourself that you are a child of God. Because Rally Day is not just a fun, yay, Sunday school. It is we are children of God. And that is beautiful, and that is costly. And we are called to be children of God together and to figure that out together. We pray with you. Lord God, help us to be children. Help us to welcome our children. Help us to be good prayer bearers. Help us to be the children of God you've called us to be, that are intergenerational, where we love on each other. We love on the people who are of different generations. Help us to bless you with the ways that we come before you with good questions and receive good questions. We pray this in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, there we go. All right.
Kids apart? Anybody? No?